Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. In the last few years, we've seen the introduction of camera tracking platforms for astrophotography, such as this one, the Ioptron Sky Tracker. Now, the idea of these platforms is they provide a way into astrophotography for people. Potentially, you've got a camera like this, a digital SLR, and you want to take pictures of the night sky without all the expense of getting into purchasing a telescope and a telescope mount. They're portable, so you can take them to dark skies and you can get into astrophotography at a lower price level than perhaps in the past where you needed to buy more kit. So platforms like this with cameras combined with lenses like this, which is the Samyang 14mm lens, a wide angle lens, they can produce fantastic results. But the idea of this video is to see whether we can do it a little bit cheaper. So this lens, the Samyang, is also sold as the Rokinon, and it's a very good astrophotography lens, but it costs around £300, which isn't cheap. Okay, it's probably cost you more than the tracking platform, which the camera is riding on top of. So this video is designed to see if we can make decent astrophotographs with cheaper lenses. So I've picked three lenses that you can buy used for very little money. Starting with a well-known lens, this is the Canon 50mm lens called the Nifty 50, and it's a well-known astrophotography lens which you can pick up used for maybe around £30-35. Moving up in focal length, you'll find that auction sites are full of old lenses, prime lenses often, that is to say single focal length lenses, and perhaps they've got mountings that don't fit modern cameras. So this is an example of a lens, it's 135mm focal length, it is f2.8, so it's relatively fast, but it had an M42 thread, so that mount has been, we've got an adapter on here to allow me to attach it to my Canon EOS, and that cost me about £25. And then finally, moving up in focal length a bit further, we've got a 200mm prime lens, so a fixed focal length lens. This one is f3.5, so it's again relatively fast, it's got a got an aperture of 50 something millimeters, and it's made by Hoya. And I picked this one up, again it's got an adapter to allow me to connect it to my EOS, and picked it up for £26. So we've got the three lenses, the 50, the 135 and the 200mm, and it doesn't matter to me that we can't use these in automatic mode, because in astrophotography you focus the targets manually. So in theory, we don't know much about the optical quality of these lenses, but we can give it a try and see what we can get for our money. So what process are we going to follow? Well, first off, I'm going to find some targets, in this case from this month's Astronomy magazine, and then we're going to line up the platform with Polaris and set it running. Now for each lens, I've chosen to take a series of 30 second exposures with the camera set at ISO 800. Now through trial and error, this seems to be a good balance in order to capture a good amount of starlight, but not to start to fog the lens. So we're going to take a series of those 30 second shots, and then we're going to stack them on top of each other using a program called Deep Sky Stacker. And that will then allow us to do any image manipulation we want to try and get the final image. So other than that, we've got the lenses, we've got the camera and the platform. You'll notice on top of the camera here, I've got a red dot finder. Now this is really an optional extra. It's a red dot finder that's got a hot shoe adapter underneath. Now the idea is that that will save us a bit of time. And just through experience of doing astrophotography with a platform like this, sometimes, especially when you get to the longer focal length lenses, it can take you a while to find your target, and that is frustrating. It wastes time, and really, with the addition of a simple accessory like this, you can speed up the process of image location. So we're going to use that to try to get through a few more images in a given time. Other than that, the only other thing we're going to use, I've got a series of these. These are step down rings, which we may use depending on the results for each lens, and they will allow us to adjust the aperture of the lens. But we'll come to those as we make some progress. Okay, so the first thing to find out is how much sky can we capture with these three lenses. So I'm using a Canon 700D, which is a camera fitted with a crop sensor. So cameras like this, they've got a field of view that's around 1.5 times smaller than a full frame camera. So when I'm using the camera with the 50mm lens, then this is what we can see. We can capture all of Orion. This is an image taken 60 frames of 30 seconds stacked on top of each other in Deep Sky Stacker. And we can see that that's an area of sky around 25 degrees by 17 degrees. So it's quite a lot of sky. If we move on to the 135mm lens, then this is the region you can see, around 9 degrees by 6 degrees, and it's enough to capture the area of Orion's belt down to Orion's sword. And then finally, for the 200mm lens, as you'd expect, a correspondingly smaller area again, this time around 6 degrees by 4 degrees. So firstly, let's have a look at some of the images I've captured using the 50mm lens. Now this is known as the Nifty 50, this lens. It's largely plastic construction, and it's got a focal ratio of f1.8. Now there is a faster lens, a 1.4, that's available, but that's more expensive, and the 1.8 is fairly easy to pick up used, and it's got a good reputation. So let's see some of the images that I've managed to capture with it. So in the summer sky, this is the North American nebula in Cygnus, and this frame is six frames, in fact, stacked on top of each other, 30 seconds again, with the lens operating at f2.8. So straight away, I think you can see that you get pretty good star images across the frame. Quite happy with that sort of result. And when you've got a large field of view that you can capture in one frame, it's quite tempting to build a mosaic. So took maybe a dozen shots here of the Cygnus region and resulted in this mosaic, which I'm pretty pleased with that for what is a very basic lens, and you can capture this sort of image quite quickly. Moving on to the 135mm lens. So this used to be quite a classic focal length for prime lenses, and this one f2.8, and it's fitted with an adapter so that the original screw thread can be mounted onto a bayonet lens, a bayonet camera like the Canon EOS. So first off, to assess the quality of the lens, I had a look at Brightstar, so Capella, and I took a series of images with different exposures and different focal ratios on the lens. Now looking over on the left, I'm a little bit dismayed. The first time I looked at the image, I could see that it's sort of bloated and distorted. So even though Capella is a multiple star system, that's not what we're seeing here. It's just not really able to capture a good quality image when we're testing the lens, if you like. It's wide open. So a bit disappointed with that. But as we move, stepping down the lens, f4 and f5.6, we get a better star image, as you might expect. But we see the introduction of some spikes. So these are the diffraction spikes that I mentioned before that are caused by the rings, the aperture iris inside the lens. So that's the sort of effect that we're going to get when we use the lens's own internal aperture control. So I tried putting a step down ring on the front of the lens, on the filter ring, in place of using the aperture inside the lens, instead of using the iris to step it down. And there was some small improvement to the image quality, but not a huge amount. So I moved on and took a few quick shots of the Orion Nebula, and again you can see quite a large field of view here. It gives you an idea of what sort of region we're talking about, and a cropped image from the same stack frame. It's reasonable quality, it's not really anything too special, but it's okay. Lenses of this focal length are really quite helpful for conjunctions between planets and deep sky objects, or maybe between planets and the moon. And we had one of those recently between the Pleiades and Mars. So I took a few frames with the 135, and yeah, a reasonable result. I guess the obvious thing is that Mars has got very prominent diffraction spikes. So moving on to the 200mm lens, this is made by Hoyer, and it's an f3.5 lens. And once again, in order to fit it onto the Canon, there's an adapter ring to convert the original thread to the bayonet of the modern camera. Once again, I went back to Capella to see a reference for the star quality, and took a couple of images initially at f5.6 on the left here. We can see the diffraction spikes that we saw previously, but this time when I fit a step down ring on the front of the lens, then it removes the spikes quite effectively. And even though I'd say neither image is perfect, we've still got quite a lot of red fringing around the star images in either case, but certainly the removal of the diffraction spikes I think is preferable to using the iris inside the lens. So I took a few frames of that Mars and Pleiades conjunction. Again, you can see this is without the step down ring, and you can see that you've got quite a lot of spikes on Mars, so that's not really satisfactory to me. Maybe it looks quite nice on a star cluster, but not when you've got a planet. So for the remaining frames, I adopted the approach of using the step down ring instead. So here's a couple of familiar galaxies, M81 and M82. Now this is the whole frame, and it gives you an idea of the field of view. This is 23 frames stacked on top of each other, and I think it's quite a pleasing result, and I think the image quality across the frame looks pretty decent. And then a crop from the same frame shows you the two galaxies. Now, yeah, obviously, as with all astro images, you could take a few more frames and get a better quality, but I think I'm quite happy with that. That's a usable image for from a £25 lens. And then moving on to another target, the Whirlpool. This shows you, I suppose, how small deep sky objects can be, and perhaps shows the difference between the field of view of a lens like this and that you might expect commonly with telescopes. But nonetheless, the full frame captures, I think, just the left of center. You can see there is a very small galaxy. And if we crop the region of the frame, there you go, that is Messier 51. Now I think really for the investment in this lens, once we've removed the diffraction spikes, I think that is a pretty reasonable result. Okay, so let's remind what the purpose of this video was. You'd like to get into astrophotography and you've got a digital SLR. So we've been looking at one option where you buy a tracking platform like this one, like the iOptron Sky Tracker or maybe the Skywatcher Star Adventurer, and you use the digital SLR with whatever lenses you've got in order to try getting some good astro images. I think we've seen that approach is going to achieve results most of the time. Certainly going to be a lot cheaper than buying a telescope, buying a mount and putting the camera onto the back of that. It's also going to be more forgiving of errors in setting up the telescope and the mount and tracking and all those other things you have to learn in order to get good astro images. So of the three lenses we've looked at, I think it's a 2 out of 3 success rate. The 200mm lens that cost, remember, about £25, and the 50mm, the Nifty 50, are both excellent choices, budget choices that will get you quite a long way into astro imaging, and they allow you to cover a range of targets. So this is quite wide field targets, and whereas we've seen some of the deep sky objects can be captured quite well with a 200mm lens. The other purchase, 135, well, for me, I probably won't use this lens a great deal more. The image quality really isn't up to much, and I suppose that part of my investment has been lost, but it wasn't a great deal of money. So what else? Well, I guess it's best to try to get as good a quality lens as you can. It is a buyer's market for these used lenses because technology moves on, and there's lots of old lenses available on the market. And as long as you can try to get as much information as you can about the lens before you buy it, either look through the lens if you can see it in person, or get some recent photographs published on, if you're buying it remotely on an auction website, try to get the seller to publish some images that show you the camera working at infinity. Other than that, we've seen stop down rings can be a cheap solution to avoiding diffraction spikes. And well, what else? It's definitely going to be worth giving it a try. There isn't much to lose when you're only spending 20, 30, 40 pounds on a lens. Definitely it's an alternative if you don't want to make a further investment, which can be a case of several hundred pounds for a high quality new lens. So I hope it's been useful. Thanks for watching and see you again.